Okay, here's the list of representative heroes for this lecture. During the first half, we'll hear more about France in the reign of Louis XV. We'll see some of the work of Jean-Baptiste Simeon Chardin, one of the most important genre and still life painters of the 18th century, to say the least, whose subject matter is very different from that of Boucher, about whom we were hearing at the end of the last lecture, but it's important to notice that they were both in the French Academy at the same time. We'll also hear about Jean-Honoré Fragonard, whose artistic personality is closer to Boucher's, and who had the misfortune, I guess, to live into an era in which the kind of thing he liked to paint was not only unpopular, but politically dangerous. Around the time of the break, we'll cross the Rhine to hear about German things for a while. We'll visit the court of Augustus the Strong in Dresden, which could be considered the cultural capital of Germany in this era. Certainly, Augustus was one of the greatest collectors of art of all sorts in the entire history of Europe. And we'll also hear more about Frederick the Great, one of the most talented kings ever to rule a country, and who was one of the few who may have recognized the true genius of Johann Sebastian Bach, about whom we'll also hear quite a bit today. This is the self-portrait by Jean-Baptiste Simeon Chardin, which we saw at the end of class last time, and I think I facetiously suggested that this might have been the expression on his face if we'd caught him looking at a picture by Boucher. He didn't like Boucher. You can't always guess what an artist is like as a person from what he does as an artist, but you could probably come pretty close with Boucher and Chardin. Will Durand, in fact, calls Chardin the most wholesome artist in history, and I think you'll see what he means shortly. He married a woman with no dowry, considered going way beyond the call of love's duty, and as a matter of fact, she looks very much like him. There's a portrait of her, which I don't have a copy of, that looks almost like this. He was primarily self-taught, but he was admitted to the French Academy, and it's a measure of his fellow artists' respect that he was not only made the treasurer of the Academy, but he was put in charge of deciding how works would be displayed at the Academy exhibits, which required a great deal of tact and unprejudiced judgment. I'm going to flash back here for just a second to the picture called the Toilette de Venus, the morning getting dressed ceremony of Venus by Boucher, which we saw last time. This is a picture that represented the taste of the court of Louis XV and Madame de Pompadour, certainly. It's sort of the R-rated version of the subject. And this now is Chardin's picture called The Morning Toilette. It's essentially the same subject, a pretty girl getting dressed, but it's about as chaste and modest a picture as you could imagine. Denis Diderot, who was so critical of Boucher in his Encyclopédie, does come close to saying that to be a great artist, a painter has to be moral. To be a great picture, to be great art, a picture has to be moral. And he, Diderot, much preferred Chardin to Boucher. I think it's okay to prefer Chardin too, but it's hard to argue, as Diderot does, that morality and great art in any medium are very closely connected. We really have to use different standards in the world of the arts than in the real world. In the real world, a man can't stand on a pedestal with no clothes on, but Michelangelo's David can do it and be universally admired. Here's Chardin's picture called Grace. This is, of course, genre art now, ordinary life art, which can present special problems for art historians, partly because it gives them less to talk about. By definition, it doesn't have famous people, great events, or things like that in it. Oscar Wilde, in fact, says that this kind of thing is easier to paint than to talk about. The influence of the Dutch, the greatest genre painters, can probably be seen in Chardin's work. Something like this could certainly remind you of pictures by Vermeer or de Hooch we saw last quarter. There's a real focus on the feminine in Chardin's work. And men, even when they appear, are almost never doing anything masculine. Here's a little girl just playing badminton. One of the most characteristic things about the visual arts in the Rococo period is just this emphasis on the feminine, of course. And this gives Boucher and Chardin, whose work seems so different from one another, an important thing in common over against the old macho world of Louis XIV. Neither one of them ever painted a battle in his life. Here's The Tea Drinker by Chardin, and this is, I suppose, one of his most Vermeer-like pictures. One thing I think we might say about pictures like this is that in a sense they speak a language we can understand even if we can't translate it or speak it ourselves. Walter Pater, the great 19th century English critic, compares the effect of this sort of picture to that of music. It creates a mood rather than conveying a message, or if it does convey a message, it's one that it's very difficult to put into language. Art historians are always trying, but it's been said that nothing hears as many stupid remarks as a painting on a wall in a museum. A lot of Chardin's pictures are, in a sense, below even the level of ordinary life. They're at the level of what we might call silly life. This fellow is just building a house of cards. He's a man, but he's not doing anything manly. Again, apropos of the difficulty of talking about this kind of subject, someone has said that almost everything said about art sounds like a bad translation. And that's because the conveying of a message from medium to medium, from painting to language, or music to language, or painting to music, or whatever, is even more difficult than conveying a message from language to language. Likewise, this fellow is just blowing bubbles. No real man in Louis XIV's day would have been caught dead blowing bubbles. Nothing could be farther from this fellow's thoughts than la gloire militaire. As Voltaire says, trifle with life, that's all it's good for. Again, there was a study done, I believe, at Stanford to try to determine in which disciplines teachers had the most trouble expressing themselves. The idea was that the number of times professors said ah and would be cited by graduate students involved in the survey. I would have expected the philosophy professors to win this contest, or lose it, depending on your viewpoint. I mean, wasn't it Descartes, after all, who said, I ah, therefore I Something like that? Well, anyway, it was found that the art history professors said ah and more than anyone else. There's one last anecdote I can't leave out, too. Tristan Bernard, the French Parisian drama critic of the early 20th century, once won a contest sponsored, I think, by Le Figaro. The idea was that famous people would imagine themselves in the Louvre and then imagine it catching on fire, and they would say what picture they would rescue and why if they could only save one from the burning building. Bernard's winning answer was, if I were in the Louvre and it caught on fire, the picture I would save would be the one nearest the door. Which goes to show, I think, that sometimes the pictures we like best, the works of art we like best, we like for reasons not really all that much connected with what they look like. Chardin is not only one of the greatest French genre painters, he's one of the greatest still life painters, and we're going to see some of the ones he painted now. This is known as the Ray in the Louvre, and it was his masterpiece in the narrow sense. When he was admitted to the Academy in 1727, he painted this picture to celebrate that. We've been hearing some of the harpsichord music of Jean-Philippe Rameau as we've been looking at these pictures by Chardin. I did mention last week that there was a good deal of controversy in the Paris music world over the relative merits of native-born French composers like Rameau vis-à-vis the merits of Italian composers like Pergolese and Marcello. And we're going to hear a piece now by Benedetto Marcello. It'd be difficult for you to judge much about the relative differences between these composers or between French and Italian music at this time from just examples like this, but this certainly is a fine piece by Marcello. It's a movement from his Cello Sonata number 2. And while we hear this, we'll see some more of the still life subjects by Chardin. A water container. The salmon. The artist paint box. Pomegranates and grapes. A detail from that. And fruit with a bowl. This is a chalk portrait of Jean-Honoré Fragonard by Jacques Lemoine. Fragonard belongs to the next generation of French 18th century painters and lived three quarters of a century right through the Revolution. He was a pupil of both Boucher and Chardin, and this picture, called The Good Mother in the Legion of Honor, is one that you might imagine to have been painted under the influence of the latter. Fragonard did win the Prix de Rome and spend 6 years in Italy, where he was more awed by Italian Renaissance painting, I think, than influenced by it. Unlike Boucher, who was, for example, contemptuous of what he called Michelangelo's hunchbacks, Fragonard thought Italian painters too far superior to him even to imitate, I think. The subject here is actually derived from a painting by Rembrandt of the Virgin and Child, but religious subjects were not part of the métier of people like Boucher or Chardin or Fragonard either. They were all good Catholics, but as far as the visual arts go, this was a secular age. This Fragonard, called The Girl Reading, is one of the most popular pictures in the Washington National Gallery. Here one might argue you can see both the influence of Boucher, the subject is, after all, a pretty girl, and then at the same time, the influence of Chardin. She's a pretty girl, but she has her clothes on. The Stolen Kiss in St. Petersburg in the Hermitage is similar. It's the kind of subject Boucher liked to paint, seduction, lovemaking, but it's so chaste in conception that it's the kind of thing Chardin probably would have done if he'd been forced at gunpoint or something like that to do this sort of subject. It's about as modest an example of seduction as one could find. But eventually it was the influence of Boucher that won out. This is called The Bathers in the Louvre. The Goncourt brothers, who are among the foremost writers on French art of the 18th century, say that this is the kind of picture that reminds them of dreams they've had while they were asleep in a box at the Paris Opera. And it's the kind of thing most people think of now when they think of Fragonard. I'm not sure this is really great art, but it certainly represents the predominant taste of its era. Some people talk as though every age and time produces its own geniuses, its own Rembrandt, and that the difference between Michelangelo's David and a Cherokee ceremonial mask is just a matter of taste. But that's a pretty hard case to make convincing. This is Fragonard's picture called A Useless Resistance in the Legion of Honor, which is basically in the same spirit of sort of soft porn frivolity as The Bathers. And the resistance doesn't look that useless. It looks like the girl has pretty well knocked her would-be suitor unconscious with that pillow. Apropos of what I was just saying, the now defunct San Francisco magazine once ran a cover story called 12 Great San Francisco Geniuses, but it was a pretty lightweight list, especially since Joe Montana wasn't even included. I'd never heard of any of them. It can be hard to get a good perspective on the accomplishments of your own day, and I really doubt that any of the geniuses in that list are going to be very highly regarded in a couple of centuries. Like Fragonard, they are at best going to be thought to represent the taste of their age. The word genius is thrown around pretty loosely today. The MacArthur Foundation claims to find at least 20 or 30 geniuses every year, but I could imagine a real genius, especially an already wealthy one, turning the award down on the grounds he didn't want to be included in the company of the rest. This is probably Fragonard's most famous picture, The Swing in the Wallace Collection in London. Kenneth Clark calls this the giddiest painting of the century. The Baron de Saint-Julien, who commissioned this, is the sort of peeping Tom at the lower left who's getting the best view of the coquette kicking off her shoe, which was considered very provocative. In the 18th century, going barefoot was considered about as risque as going topless. Here she is up closer. She does have a kind of manic look in her eye. Someone, Kenneth Clark perhaps, says that this was the golden age of vice, but the vices were practiced so elegantly they were mistaken for virtues. The Wallace Collection, where this is certainly a great place to visit, especially if you like 18th century art, the Wallace Collection in London, in a grand old mansion. After Madame de Pompadour died, the king's last famous mistress, Madame du Barry, about whom we'll hear more in a minute, commissioned a series of pictures called The Progress of Love from Fragonard. This is the climax, the lover crowned. It would seem that this would have been just the sort of thing Madame du Barry would have wanted, but for some reason she didn't like the pictures, and Fragonard had to take them all back to the family estate at Grasse in Provence. Since they weren't completed until the 1770s, it may be that she just thought they were too old-fashioned. The Rococo style was, in fact, on the way out by that time, and soon would be regarded as not only old-fashioned, but very politically incorrect. By the time of the Revolution, it was a style that was looked upon as representative of all the vices of the bad old Ancien Régime, although I think it could be argued that there is something of Rousseau, his sentimentalism, in Fragonard's treatment of romantic love. The fellow at the right, who seems to represent the artist, could hardly be a self-portrait. Fragonard was over 40 by this time. The crowned lover also seems pretty rather than masculine, and young enough to be the son of his beloved, but this sort of thing is again not atypical of the treatment of men in this feminine age. This is now in the Frick Collection in New York. As I said, Fragonard lived a long life, and in a way, it might have been better if he'd lived a bit shorter one, because, as I just said, his way of painting went out altogether, out of style altogether, before the end of the century. This is a portrait he painted of an interesting friend of his, the Abbé de Saint-Nom, with whom he had traveled in Italy, and who was at one time an actor, and he's depicted here as one, but he was also at various times a writer, an engraver. This picture is painted in quite a different, and one might argue, a more masculine style. In this detail, the brushwork looks almost like it could be from some modern abstract painting. But after the 1780s, Fragonard got few commissions from people other than his friends. One of the few good things that can be said about Jacques-Louis David as a person rather than as an artist is that he helped support Fragonard when the latter fell out of fashion and was kicked out of his state-supported apartment in the Louvre. This is a portrait of the painter Hubert Robert, a good friend of Fragonard's, by Madame Vigée Lebrun, a woman about whom we'll hear a lot more later. Robert is another fellow like Saint-Nom, who knew Fragonard in Italy and who was known himself as something of an adventurer. On one occasion, he got lost in the catacombs and nearly starved to death. Like Fragonard, he also had trouble with the revolution and only escaped the guillotine because he was mistaken for someone who was to be freed, or according to another story, because of confusion about whether his name was Hubert Robert or Robert Hubert. Anyway, he survived and was eventually made curator of the Louvre by Napoleon, and the pictures in the gallery there were essentially arranged in the way he laid them out until the recent remodeling. He's best known for his paintings of pictures of Italian ruins, sort of in the manner of a Piranese in color, but this isn't an Italian ruin. This is the Grand Gallery of the Louvre itself, as it might look in 500 years. Now this is the Countess du Barry, who became the king's mistress sans titre in 1769 after the death of Pompadour. This is the du Barry who commissioned the pictures we saw a minute ago from Fragonard. She was the illegitimate daughter of an unknown father and a lower class woman of Paris. And when her mother began to feel her husband was showing an inappropriate interest in his stepdaughter, the future Madame du Barry was kicked out of the house and found a job as a dressmaker's assistant in a shop on the Rue de Faubourg Saint-Honoré, even in the 18th century, a center of Parisian fashion. Unfortunately, men began hanging around fighting over her on the sidewalk in front of the store, which proved bad for business, so she was fired from that job and eventually became the presumed mistress of a gambler and rascal named Jean du Barry, who was on the fringes of court society and at least an acquaintance of the Duc de Richelieu, the frequent bather I mentioned last time. Through the latter, she met the king, who immediately fell for her. For the sake of appearances, her marriage to du Barry's brother was arranged, that's how she got the name du Barry, but she lived with the king at Versailles. When Richelieu later asked the king what there was especially about du Barry that appealed to him, his answer was, "She's the one who can make me forget I'm almost 60." Here you can see part of her suite of apartments at Versailles. She was perhaps not as much of an influence on the king, art, politics, etc. as Pompadour, but she did make an impact. It was, for example, essentially du Barry who was responsible for getting the Duc de Choiseul, Louis's foreign minister, fired for reasons that were essentially personal. After the king died just 5 years later, that is, after he had met du Barry in 1774, du Barry became friendly with the Duc de Brissac, with whom she lived until the Revolution. When she became something of a heroine to the nobility who had shunned her after the death of Louis XV, she made trips back and forth between France and England, carrying messages and money for émigrés abroad. In 1793, however, she was caught at this and guillotined. Sometimes last words sound fabricated, but those attributed to Madame du Barry have the ring of authenticity. She's supposed to have looked up at the executioner and to have said, "Oh, please, just one more minute. One more minute. Life is so sweet." That sounds right. The most important architect of the age of Louis XV in France was Jacques-Ange Gabriel. He's most famous for laying out the Place de la Concorde in Paris and for putting up the buildings which fronted on either side of the Rue Royale, as we'll see later. He also did a lot of work remodeling chateaus here and there, and at Versailles he built the Opera House, which we'll also see later. This is a small-scale work by him on the grounds of Versailles. It's called the French Pavilion, and it was used as a sort of way station for those strolling the grounds, a place where lemonade or hot chocolate, depending on the weather, was available, for example. He also built the Petit Trianon. Again, on the grounds of Versailles, this was originally to be used as a sort of getaway by the king and Madame de Pompadour, but it was not finished until after her death, so it was the king and du Barry, rather, who made use of it. Kenneth Clark says that in architecture, this is as near perfection as may be. The eye-pleasing proportions of it are always mentioned by art historians, and it is almost always regarded as a finer artistic achievement than Versailles itself. There's a point, I think, at which size can become detrimental to beauty, and Versailles may well be thought to pass that point. Louis XV wanted to die here. He had come down with smallpox in 1774, but his doctor in the court wouldn't allow this. The king had to die at Versailles. So against his wishes, he was hauled back to the main palace, where he did die a few days later. He was succeeded by his grandson, the 20-year-old Louis XVI, and his wife Marie Antoinette. And we'll be back to hear about them in due time, but for a while now we're going to cross the Rhine into Germany. Here's a map now on which you should note the locations of some cities and of Prussia. If you can remember back to the time of the War of the Spanish Succession in Louis XIV's day, you may recall that the fellow who contested Louis's claim to the throne of Spain on behalf of his grandson was the Holy Roman Emperor Leopold. To get support for his claim, Leopold allowed, and I'm simplifying somewhat here, Leopold allowed Ernst Augustus, the Margrave of Brunswick, to become Kurfürst of Hanover, the ninth elector in the empire. His son, in fact, will become the King of England, as George I, as we'll see later. He also allowed this fellow, the Margrave of Brandenburg, who was married to Ernst Augustus's daughter, Sophie Charlotte, and who was already an elector, to call himself Frederick I, King of Prussia. Again, this is a bit of an oversimplification, but that's the essence of it. This marks the point, really, at which Hanover and Prussia begin to make an entrance on the stage of world history. When he became Frederick I of Prussia, his brother, Christian Ludwig, got the old title Margrave of Brandenburg, and it was to this fellow, Christian Ludwig, that Bach dedicated the Brandenburg Concerti. It was to him that they were sent. And we're going to hear more about Bach shortly, and we're going to hear one of the Brandenburg Concerti in part as we go ahead at this point. In Berlin, for his wife Sophie Charlotte, Frederick I of Prussia built this palace, still known by her name as the Charlottenburg. At the time it was built, it was well outside the city, but by the time of the Second World War, the city had expanded to include it and was an obvious target for Allied bombers, but it has now been restored and is the most impressive piece of 18th century architecture surviving in the city of Berlin. The original architect was a fellow named Nering, but the most famous architect connected with it was Georg von Knobelsdorff, who finished it with the west wing to the right in this view, added in Frederick the Great's day some 50 years after the palace was begun. Here's the dome up closer from the other side. It was the work of still another architect here named Goethe, who was not, as far as I know, related to the author of the same name. In the courtyard below, you can also see a statue of Frederick I's father, Frederick William, the great elector, who made Brandenburg the strongest electorate in the empire, paving the way for his son to become the King of Prussia in the way I've just mentioned. This is part of the suite now, which belonged to Queen Sophie Charlotte, Frederick I's second wife. She is considered one of the most cultivated women of the age. She was a friend of Gottfried Wilhelm von Leibniz, who had served her father, Ernst Augustus, created Elector of Hanover, as I just said, in all sorts of scientific and political ways. Later, she was instrumental in the creation of the Berlin Academy of Sciences, of which Leibniz became the first president. Leibniz is remembered mostly for calculus, though there were other mathematicians who apparently achieved this breakthrough at about the same time. And he's remembered for, in effect, claiming that this is the best of all possible worlds. However, he also made all sorts of other contributions to mathematics, the sciences, philosophy, logic, and so on. The business about this being the best of all possible worlds has, however, exposed him to a lot of ridicule over the centuries. This is the porcelain cabinet now in the Charlottenburg. Even though he didn't actually use the phrase best of all possible worlds, like Alexander Pope in England, Leibniz did think that if God's really in charge, this must be the best things can get. Whatever is right, and all partial evil is universal good, as Pope says. The phrase best of all possible worlds itself comes from Voltaire's Candide, about which we'll hear later, in which in a combination of easy fun and black humor, makes the idea look really silly. Although Frederick and Sophie Charlotte were great fans of porcelain, this is now more a museum than a collection of things they owned. We'll hear about Meissen in a few minutes, and it is, of course, one of the most famous centers for the production of high-quality porcelain ever. Augustus the Strong in Dresden once gave Frederick Wilhelm, Frederick I's son, a 5,000-piece set of Meissenware when they were friends, and after they quarreled, he smashed the whole set. When Sophie Charlotte died in 1705, Frederick I married a third wife, Sophie Louise, and she was so eccentric as to be barely sane. This is called the Golden Room now in the Knobelsnor for West Wing, which wasn't finished until long after Frederick I's death. The story goes that one night in 1713, wrapped in a white sheet, she burst in on him when he was in bed. He thought she was a ghost and dropped dead on the spot, or something like that. This part of the palace was actually finished in his grandson Frederick the Great's day, when the taste for the Rococo in Germany was at its height. Now this is Frederick I's son, Frederick William, by an anonymous artist. Sometimes called the drill sergeant of the Prussian nation, he had little interest in the superficial splendor usually considered de rigueur for world-class kings, and focused his attention on improving the Prussian economy as a whole and on military affairs. He was not a great soldier himself, but he left to his son, who would be a great one, Frederick the Great, in fact, one of the best organized armies in Europe. One of his less successful enterprises in this regard was the creation of a special body of soldiers who were 7 feet tall. Despite their mediocre success as soldiers, this regiment was kept around till the First World War. There's a memorable anecdote apropos of this. When Kaiser Wilhelm was threatening to invade Holland and said he would send in the seven footers, Queen Wilhelmina responded, "How tall did you say they are? 7 feet? Well, when we open the dikes, the water's 8 feet deep." Whether this dissuaded him or not, I don't know, but Holland wasn't invaded. Here you see him on the right with another of the age's memorable characters, Augustus the Strong, Duke of Saxony and part-time King of Poland. This was painted by the Frenchman Louis de Sylvestre, then working at Augustus's court in Dresden. In 1728, Augustus accused Frederick William, in fact, of kidnapping Saxon seven-footers to serve in his Prussian regiment of giants, and Frederick William came to Dresden with his then 12-year-old son, the future Frederick the Great, to talk about this and other matters. Augustus is famous for a lot of reasons. He was, first of all, the father of something like 360 illegitimate children, and although other men may well have fathered more than that, Augustus, I think, holds the record for the number actually kept track of. At a party for them once, he had a cake baked that held the record as the largest cake ever baked, according to the Guinness Book of World Records, until it was exceeded in size by one baked for the Seattle World's Fair. Augustus has had 5,000 eggs in it. Here's another portrait of Augustus by Sylvestre. The office of King of Poland was elective in the sense that the nobility chose the king, but he had to be a Catholic, and Augustus was a Protestant, so he simply converted. At this, his long-suffering wife, Christine of Hohenzollern, left him. She put up with the whole palace full of his bastards, but when he became a Catholic, that was the last straw. I know a good slogan he could have used in his attempt to get the vote on his side in Poland. "Vote for me, vote for Augustus, I might be your father." Now Dresden, which you see here in a modern photograph from the opposite side of the Elbe River, was the home of Augustus the Strong, although he did spend time in Warsaw. It was essentially leveled by Allied bombing at the end of the Second World War. Half a century later now, people sometimes argue that the bombing of Dresden was unnecessary, that it could have been avoided and so on, But if anyone ever played a no-holds-barred game, it was Hitler. And if anyone had asked me about this in 1945, I'm afraid I'd have said bombs away. Which doesn't mean I'm not glad that it's now well on its way to becoming what it was at the time, one of the most splendid cities in Germany. And anyone with any feeling for the cultural contributions of the place has to be glad that virtually all the portable art here, at least, was saved from the bombing. To the right in this picture, you can see the Hofkirche, which was built by Augustus the Strong as a Catholic church. And to the left is the Frauenkirche, which was originally to have been left a ruin after the Allied bombing as a sort of memento belli or war memorial. But now it's being reconstructed also. We'll see it in a bit. In the mid-18th century, Bernardo Bellotto, the nephew of the more famous Canaletto, visited Dresden and painted a series of views that are about as close to photos as we could want. And in this picture, we get more or less the same perspective on the city as in the modern photo we just saw. Here's a closer view of that picture. Bellotto's style is almost indistinguishable from that of his uncle. About the only way to tell them apart is by subject. Bellotto spent time in Dresden, and Canaletto was never there, so this has to be Bellotto. Canaletto is mostly famous for his views of Venice and London, which we'll see in the future. Here's the Zwinger Palace now. This is a modern photograph, of course. It was built by the architect Daniel Poppelman for Augustus the Strong in Dresden. We'll hear more about Bach later, as I've said. You're hearing, again, part of one of the Brandenburg Concertos as I speak, but Dresden did play a considerable part in his career, although he never really lived here. In 1717, he was scheduled to compete in an organ-playing contest at the Frauenkirche against the French virtuoso Jean-Louis Marchand, but the story goes that Marchand snuck in and heard him practicing before the contest and left town on the next stage. When he was in Leipzig, Bach himself made several visits to Dresden to hear musical performances. Bach's son, Wilhelm Friedemann, was in Augustus the Strong's orchestra. And in 1733, Bach sent the B minor mass here, but Augustus had just died and his son had a lot on his mind and it was never performed, apparently. Also, the Goldberg Variations were written for the Russian ambassador to Dresden. Johann Goldberg was a child prodigy keyboardist who had been brought to Dresden by this fellow, the Russian ambassador to Dresden, Count Kaiserling. Wilhelm Friedemann, Bach's son, who was in Augustus's orchestra, took him to Leipzig several times to receive instruction from Johann Sebastian, and the so-called Goldberg Variations were composed at Kaiserling's request, apparently with Goldberg in mind as the performer. Kaiserling's supposed to have been so impressed by the whole set of variations that he gave Bach a snuff box with 100 louis d'or in it. I'm not sure exactly what that was worth, but it was a whole lot. They were then likely first performed here in Dresden, and we're going to see more of this wonderful city now as it looks today and as it looked to Bernardo Bellotto and others in the 18th century while we hear part of the Goldberg Variations. One last thing before we start here, too. You can see the Semper Opera House, the 19th century opera house restored again after the Second World War there, just above the Zwinger in this picture. And that reminds me of Wagner's career here. We won't get to him, of course, this quarter, but Lohengrin was written here. Three or four of his other operas premiered here. And then, of course, back in the 17th century, Heinrich Schütz, maybe the first great German composer, was in Dresden. This is Bellotto's view of the Zwinger courtyard, looking east, sort of southeast toward the Kreuzkirche in the distance. It was destroyed in the Seven Years' War. Here's a close-up of the right-hand part of the courtyard picture. That's the Crown Gate, as it's called. And this is a photograph of that gate as it looks today. And here you see the Altmarkt with the Kreuzkirche. It's on the square called the Altmarkt now, the old market square. And this is the way it looks up a little closer now. The Altmarkt was entirely destroyed in the Second World War and
has been rebuilt rather than restored.
The Kreuzkirche has been restored to its 18th century appearance. It's been rebuilt twice since it looked as it did in Bach's day. This is the Neumarkt now with the Frauenkirche. Built in 1726 as what was then the largest church in Germany built by Protestants.
And the Neumarkt today with the newly reconstructed Frauenkirche as the center of attention.
And the Schloss, Augustus's residence, official residence. The Zwinger was just an auxiliary palace. He built this, and again, it was so heavily damaged in the Second World War that it virtually had to be entirely rebuilt. Well, that's where we'll take the break now.